subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We've all seen pictures of the riots in Bangladesh in the wake of Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit. These riots took place in many districts, particularly in Chittagong area, but also not far from Dhaka in some places. These rioters were led, or groups leading the riots were Islamist conservative groups, and their protest was that Narendra Modi is anti-Muslim, he victimizes the Muslim minority in India, he had no business to be in Bangladesh, and so on and so forth. It was a typical subcontinental riot. Trains were burnt, vehicles were burnt, buildings were attacked. In this case, temples were also attacked. Some temples were attacked and several people died. There's no point my giving you the precise figure because the figures change and they get updated, but at least people have died in double figures, many in police firing. In fact, a few had died in police firing even while Narendra Modi was in Dhaka. Now, following this, I put out a tweet yesterday, and you will see that tweet. In that tweet, I said that you see what's happened in Bangladesh. When you see these protests and you see the power that Islamists still have, that conservative groups still have, we have to appreciate the challenge that Sheikh Hasina Wazid faces there, particularly vis-a-vis her policy towards India, which is friendly. She is India's only friend in our neighborhood. Also, her own policies in her domestic politics, which give precedence to secular principles, and also protect her minorities, and how she's been pushing back her fundamentalist forces. And I said, that is why, because we in India should value our friendship with Bangladesh, we should not be rude about Bangladeshis, termites, throw them in the Bay of Bengal, etc., and also be respectful about them, because they are very useful and very good friends. Plus, it's a country on the up. It is leaving India behind in many areas, particularly social indicators. Having said that, two things happened. One, and so I must credit two women journalists for having sparked today's Cut the Clutter. One, when I woke up this morning, I found a message from Suhasini Haider, who's now a senior correspondent at The Hindu. She covers international affairs. And she pointed out to me that actually the group that led these riots has probably been patronized by Sheikh Hasina Wazid. And she forwarded to me a research report by a risk management firm called Grid 91, which I'm sharing with you. So I read through that and I figured that this was, once again, just as I said, a typical subcontinental riot. This is a subcontinental conspiracy, or a subcontinental sort of wheels within the wheels within the wheels, or multi-layered story. So that set me thinking. The other thing that happened was that another journalist, Ashfaq Masoodi, also tweeted, objecting to my having used the expression Jamaatis in my tweet. Now, I had used Jamaatis with reference to Jamaat-e-Islami in Bangladesh, because Jamaat-e-Islami in Bangladesh has always been seen to be pro-Pakistan, very Islamist, anti-democracy, anti-secular, wanting an Islamic state. It collaborated with the Pakistanis in 1971 during the war. It was party to many of the biggest massacres. In fact, the Razakars, who worked with the Pakistani army, who guided them even in the Dhaka University, infamous Dhaka University massacre, were all linked to Jamaat-e-Islami. In fact, immediately after the war, Bangladesh government had banned Jamaat-e-Islami, and its leader at that point, Ghulam Azam, had fled to West Pakistan. In West Pakistan, he had launched a restoration of East Pakistan movement. So he wanted to re-liberate Bangladesh as a unit of Pakistan. And then the story goes on and on. We are not talking about that. So that is the context in which I had used it. So the question was that if you say Jamaatis, it sounds like you are painting all of the Muslims with a broad brush. And I know that right now there is sensitivity also because of another Jamaat, Tablighi Jamaat, Now, Tablighi Jamaat and Jamaat-e-Islami are very different. And Jamaat-e-Islami in different parts of the subcontinent are very different. In Afghanistan, it was led by the Mujahideen leader Burhanuddin Rabbani. In Pakistan, Jamaat has been a very close partner with the army and the establishment and the ISI. In fact, in the days I used to travel to Pakistan as a reporter, I used to see quite often Mr. Qazi Hussain Ahmed, who was the chief or the Amir of Jamaat-e-Islami in Pakistan. And in fact, in one of the interviews, and I think I'll be able to share that interview with you from India Today's marvelous archives, I asked him far too many questions and he said to me, aap jo sawal pooch rahe hain, ye sahafi ke sawal nahi hain. The questions you are asking me are not a journalist question. So maine kaha, fir ye kiske sawal hai? So he said, ye intelligence ke sawal hai. So, you know, I was asking usual questions about his politics, his view on Afghanistan, the Mujahideen, Kashmir, Pakistani activities on the Indian side of line of control, etc., etc. So that was another Jamaat-e-Islami. Jamaat-e-Islami in India is different. It is legal and legitimate. It was founded in India in 1941-42, thereabouts, by Maulana Maududi. And also, Jamaat-e-Islami, say in Kashmir, where it's banned, is different. Also in Bangladesh, it's been banned. So I told you it was banned first in 1971, that it went through a checkered life because Mujibur Rahman was assassinated in 1975. Zia came to power in Bangladesh, Ziaur Rahman, he then lifted the ban on Jamaat-e-Islami because he was of the other persuasion, of the Islamist persuasion. So Jamaat-e-Islami came back, it became a party, it also became then an ally of BNP, Bangladesh National Party of Khalida Zia, that is Ziaur Rahman's widow's party, has also contested elections and reached as high, which is high for religious parties in the subcontinent, 17 seats I think in 2001 and 18 seats in 1991 in a house of 300. Now last election it just got 2 seats and after that it was banned. And how it was banned again is a complex story, because a bunch of people went to court saying that registration of this party should be cancelled in Bangladesh given its record, etc. The High Court cancelled it and the Supreme Court of Bangladesh on August 5, 2013 upheld that ban. When they upheld that ban almost 8 years back, that led to massive riots and protests, because remember, even BNP, Khalida Zia's party, had lost an ally. And also remember that Sheikh Hasina's government had set up an international crimes tribunal which was trying those suspected of having participated in the massacres and mass rapes and atrocities in 1971. Many of them were senior members of Begum Khalida Zia's party, of BNP. In fact, two of them were given the death sentence, as were many leaders of the Jamaat-e-Islami. In fact, the citizenship of Ghulam Azam was withdrawn, and some of those leaders are still hiding in Pakistan and also using Pakistani passports. So Jamaat-e-Islami is a key factor in whatever happened subsequently. Now, when a force like Jamaat-e-Islami vanished, then another force was needed. And that force came in the form of Hifazat-e-Islam, that is Protectors of Islam. Now, Hifazat-e-Islam was set up by a cleric, who's also a scholar. In fact, he was a chairman of Qaumi Madarsa Education Board of Bangladesh. His name was Shah Ahmad Shafi. He died just in September last year at the ripe old age of 104. He was born in 1916. He was a disciple of an Indian cleric, the head of Deoband, Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani. Now Madani is a familiar name in India. Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani, one of his sons, Asad, was a member of parliament for Congress party. His son in turn, that is Maulana Mahmood Madani, who's a familiar face on our TV channels And usually when Musharraf would come to India in these media conclaves, etc., he would be in the audience to give Musharraf a hard time. So Maulana Mehmood Madni is his grandson. So this Bangladeshi Maulana was a student of Maulana Hussain Madni. So he had his madarsas and he had his Islamic education empire. In 2009, something interesting happened in Bangladesh. In 2009, now this was Sheikh Hasina's government, progressive, secular, looking ahead. They came up with a women's development program. Under that program, women were to be given equal right of inheritance in Bangladesh. That led to trouble and protests by the Islamists. By this time, Jamaat was getting weaker. Jamaat had not yet been re-banned. That only happened in 2013. But Jamaat already was weaker. So another group came up. This group was led by this cleric, by Maulana Shah Ahmad Shafi, who became the Amir of a new organization called Hifazat-e-Islam. And they protested against this law giving equal rights of inheritance from parents to women. Jamaat-e-Islami joined them. Under pressure, Bangladesh Parliament did pass a law, but they watered it down greatly. So as often things happen in sort of situations where fundamentalist forces are looking for an opportunity, they find that excuse through something to deal with women, something that empowers women. And that is what happened in this case. Now, 2013, as we know, the Jamaat got banned. Because Jamaat got banned, another force rose. And that force, because it had already been founded in 2010, that was Hifazat-e-Islam. That quietly moved into that space. Although they were very clever, they said that they supported the Bangladesh Liberation War of 1971. They wanted punishment for those who had committed atrocities, but they wanted milder punishments for them. And soon enough, the pretenses were gone because they were making pretty much the same demands as the Jamaat-e-Islami. So they became Jamaat-e-Islami Mark II or Jamaat-e-Islami 2000. Or if I may say so, their name was Hifazat-e-Islam, but they were the new Jamaatis, which is the reason I also use that expression, Jamaatis, for them. Because Jamaat-e-Islami may have been banned, but the intellectual and ideological and philosophical and religious and spiritual or fundamentalist impulse that made it exist and prosper all this while was still there. That was inherited by this new group. Now, a couple of more interesting things happened. In 2013, there was in Bangladesh a kind of an outbreak of liberal protest, like a Bangladeshi Woodstock of Bangladeshi politics in a way. So tens of thousands of people, bloggers, atheists, secular people, they gathered in a square called Shahbag Square in Dhaka. And among the many things they demanded equal rights for all genders. They wanted a more secular constitution and system of governance. But they also wanted death sentence for some Jamaat-e-Islami clerics or leaders who had been convicted for war crimes in 1971 were given only the life sentence, not death sentence. This became a very big movement. Literally tens of thousands of people had collected there. These were mostly young people. Many were bloggers. Many were atheists. They were gays. This was a truly liberal street movement in Bangladesh. Now, to counter that came out Hifazat-e-Islam. And Hifazat-e-Islam marched its own people into Dhaka. And it was almost a clash-like situation. Some clashes did take place. Awami League's workers, Awami League is Sheikh Hasina's party, they also joined in some cases with weapons. So these Hifazat-e-Islam protesters then took refuge in mosques and said they were refusing to go away, and then force was used and they were evicted, and lots of lives were lost. After that there were many controversies, government claiming only a dozen died, human rights organizations internationally claiming maybe The number of dead was close to 100 or at least more than 50. And the Islamists claiming that hundreds or thousands had been killed. Now, just as we talk about Hifazat-e-Islam becoming the new Jamaat-e-Islami, we have to mention two names. One name was Dilawar Hussain Saidi. He was a former leader of Jamaat-e-Islami who was caught and hanged. Also, Jahanara Imam. Jahanara Imam was a teacher and a very brave teacher. She'd lost her husband and two sons on the battlefront fighting for Mukti Bahini against the Pakistanis and their collaborators in 1971. So she had launched a big campaign, a public protest against Jamaat-e-Islami, and that had led to the ban on Jamaat-e-Islami, and that is how it morphed into another organization. Although once again, Hifazat-e-Islam will say they have nothing to do with Jamaat-e-Islami, but they've inherited the same energy. Now look at also the demands that HEI or Hifazat-e-Islami came up with. They produced a 13-point charter of demands for Bangladesh government of Sheikh Hasina. I will quickly read through them, not in detail, and you will see them on the screen. And you will see them on the screen. In fact, I'll take a screenshot from this research organization's Grid 91's report. Number one, reinstate the phrase absolute trust and faith in Almighty Allah as one of the principles of state policy. Now, we had mentioned some of this in our earlier Cut the Clutter on Bangladesh on the eve of Modi's visit, which I will share with you. But basically, when Bangladesh's constitution was drafted in 1972, it was a socialist secular constitution. It did not mention any religion. The four founding principles of Bangladesh were socialism, secularism, nationalism, and democracy. It is later when Ziaur Rahman took over under martial law that he passed many proclamations or farmans, which were later all brought into the constitution. There he began the preamble. Just even before the preamble, he inserted Bismillah Rahman or Rahim. That is, in the name of the Allah, most beneficent, merciful. That done, he also took out secular from the four principles. In place of secular, this sentence was added: absolute trust and faith in Almighty Allah as one of the principles. This was taken out later as reform again started in Bangladesh after Sheikh Hasina rose back in power, Khalida Zia lost power, more democracy came in, and the courts intervened. And as we had mentioned in our earlier Cut the Clutter, the court said that this completely takes away the spirit of the constitution. So please take this stuff out. So this was taken out. Meanwhile, one thing had happened, that under General Irshad, another little subsection was added to the constitution that said that Islam will be the religion of the state, but all faiths will have the freedom to practice their own religions in complete peace and harmony. But that did not still describe Bangladesh as an Islamic Republic. The important thing is Bangladesh has never become an Islamic Republic. And this one line, absolute trust and faith in Almighty Allah, that was removed. So the first demand that Hifazat-e-Islam has is that they want this restored. So you know, they want, what kind of a republic do they want? They want an Islamic Republic. Number two, they want capital punishment for blaspheming Allah, the Holy Prophet, or any quote-unquote smear campaign against Muslims. Then clamp down on all anti-Muslim bloggers. So this is really Islamists versus bloggers. Fourth, and they've killed many bloggers in the process. They, as in fundamentalist forces, have killed many, many bloggers and atheists. Their lives have been very tough in Bangladesh. Next, stop attacking Islamic scholars, madrasa students, and profit-loving Islamists. So once again, in the same spirit. Next, release all arrested Islamic scholars and madrasa students. Then, declare Ahmadiyyas non-Muslims and stop their publicity and propaganda. So the same as in Pakistan. Next, lift restrictions on all mosques and all religious programs. Foreign cultural influences, mixing of men and women, increase in shamelessness and shameless behavior in the name of freedom of expression should all be stopped. So this is as much of a Sharia invocation as you can find. Then it goes on that Dhaka always used to be a city of mosques. Why is it becoming a city of statues? And there's a little background to that. The Supreme Court of Bangladesh, in its wisdom, decided to commission the building of a stainless steel statue of Themis, the Greek goddess of justice, the familiar figure of goddess Themis holding the scales of justice. So this was put up in the compound of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh in Dhaka. Hifazat-e-Islam and other groups protested, saying that this was, you are bringing back idolatry and idol worship, and also this is Bengal, Bangladesh is also Bengal. So there were lots of busts and statues of leaders, famous figures, artists, scholars put up at street squares or at street corners. Now they wanted all of them out. So they said, now when this protest happened, Sheikh Hasina actually relented, and that is seen as one of the areas where Sheikh Hasina actually appeased Hifazat-e-Islam. She agreed for that statue to be removed from the Supreme Court, saying it's a Greek goddess, why do we need her statue to be in this place? But basically, this group now said, Hifazat-e-Islam said, that remove all statues and busts anywhere in Bangladesh. Those mean idolatry, except inside Hindu temples. They didn't say remove those, but they said everything else has to be removed. Then they went on to say, stop anti-Islam women's policy. So anti-Islam women's development policy we told you about is what gave women equal rights in inheritance, and make Islamic education compulsory. Then they go on to say, stop intimidating and threatening students of madrasas, khatibs, imams and scholars, the same as we said before. Stop creating hatred among younger generation against Islam, and if the media does it, take strong action against media. So this is once again a call for action against secular forces. And next, number 13, all anti-Islam activities by NGOs, evil attempts by Ahmadiyyas, and conversions by Christians, particularly in Chittagong Hill Tract, should be stopped. So this is the 13-point agenda. Once you read this agenda, then you get a very good idea who they are and what do they want. In 2016 April, another bunch of protests started, and this protest started because, as we had told you earlier, under General Irshad, another subsection in the Constitution had been entered. This was the 8th Amendment, and this was in Section 2A. A new amendment was inserted that said, quote unquote, the state religion of the Republic is Islam, but other religions may be practiced in peace and harmony. Now somebody went to court saying that this was also against the spirit of Bangladeshi constitution, and this should be deleted, this should be repealed. This case was in the court, and once again Hifazat-e-Islam led a movement against it, and it does look like that yet again Sheikh Hasina's government bent over backwards to accommodate it, and the court then dismissed this case on a technicality that people who had come with this case didn't really have a locus standi. So when the courts, when judiciary is not strong enough and they get a directive from you know where, they sometimes find these shortcuts. Unfortunately, we've seen some of that happening in our country as well. Again in 2017 September, Hifazat-e-Islam came back, now on the Rohingya issue, and they demanded a jihad on Myanmar. They want Bangladesh to declare war on Myanmar, to launch a jihad to liberate the Rakhine province from Myanmar. That didn't go very far, but it became quite a strong movement because, after all, Bangladesh does have a million plus Rohingya refugees, and they come back with terrible stories. In fact, the armed organization of Rohingya refugees, that is Arakan Rohingya Salvation Army, ARSA, they've been in touch with Hifazat-e-Islam, and Hifazat-e-Islam has been demanding the arming of refugees at least, even if Bangladesh army does not launch a war on
Myanmar.
Now, Shah Ahmad Shafi, the founder of Hifazat-e-Islam, as we told you, was a student of Deoband in India, and he wasn't particularly anti-Indian. He just was a very conservative Islamic cleric. In fact, even at the age of 104, when he felt really sick, he came to treatment to India. Now, his son, who is Anas Shafi apparently is not as much of a political figure as his father was, and also as much as his other colleagues in his organization may want to be. And it is widely believed that he might be friendly to the Sheikh Hasina government, and Sheikh Hasina government also indulges him, which might be something that she is paying for now, because in the process, what has happened to Bangladesh is that a new Jamaat-e-Islami has now come in. So I will share two articles with you in addition to everything else I said to give you some background. One is an article by Sumi Khan on the Charbagh movement, and second by Taufiq Imbros Khalidi on the rise of Hifazat-e-Islam. The rise of Hifazat-e-Islam, the force behind current protests, the new Islamist conservative force, the rising new force in Bangladesh, with which definitely Sheikh Hasina's government has flirted at some points, but it's a mistake that all democratic governments make. In trying to control one set of extremists, they often play with the other set that looks less worse than the other. In the course of time, they all become Frankensteins.